I'm making a game where you get to explore a huge modern metropolis. I use procedural generation to create the environment, as it allows me to create a city that is both vast and dense. The generation happens at runtime, meaning the city's geometry and layout is generated on the fly as you move through it, rather than being stored in the memory. That's why, even though the environment looks static, it's anything but. As you navigate the game world, objects are constantly created and destroyed, and that's how I'm able to create a city of this scale with relatively few resources. But of course everything comes at a cost, so today I'd like to talk about the performance of such environments and how I make sure it runs relatively smoothly despite the enormous amount of computation that happens every frame. But before I get into it, I'd like to mention that this is still work in progress. I know that performance is not perfect right now and there are occasional frame drops. I just want to share the general approach that allows me to generate a city like this in real time at all at an acceptable frame rate. And a shout out to my patrons on Patreon. Thank you so much for supporting my work on this project. I'm using Unreal Engine 5, and like any engine, it comes with its benefits and drawbacks. The main benefit that I am taking a full advantage of is the texture and mesh streaming. Unreal does a fantastic job with this, so I can just spawn an object in the game world, seamlessly load the assets required to render it, and unload them as the object is destroyed with just the basic engine functions. This is an easy part for me as a developer, as the engine handles this process automatically, so I won't linger on it. Unreal Engine also provides a nice set of tools to handle instancing. Normally, when a 3D model is displayed in the game world, the GPU has to receive the data for what to draw, like the positions of the vertices. This is called a draw call. But when you need to draw multiple copies of the same object, you don't have to transmit the full set of data for each one. All you have to do is transmit the transforms of those additional copies, which means you can render them all in just one draw call. Unreal Engine provides easy access to this functionality, so I can create vast cityscapes with very few draw calls by simply copying the same mesh with different parameters. It also supports custom data that I can set on individual copies, which can affect its appearance. For example, all the chairs you see here are instances of the same mesh, but their colors are different due to the different custom data I'm generating for each one. Unreal also provides an easy way to create levels of detail for each mesh, which can seamlessly work with the instancing system to create a very optimized scene where objects further away are less detailed and instanced. Now, let's move on to the downsides of the engine that I have to deal with and how I overcome them. By the way, I'm trying to keep it general and not get too deep into the technical details of the engine, just so it's clear that these ideas are applicable to games developed in other engines as well. One of the downsides of Unreal Engine that I've had to overcome is the necessity for pooling. Creating and destroying actors in Unreal is quite slow, so creating and destroying hundreds of objects at a time causes noticeable stutter. This is why I've had to implement a custom pooling system. Pooling simply means that instead of destroying an object, you hide it and add it to a pool of inactive objects of that type. And when you need to create this kind of object, instead of calling the expensive object spawn functionality, you just pick one from the pool and put it where you need it. This is a bit more complicated than that because a lot of the objects I reuse that way are procedural, so not only do I have to show and hide an object, I also have to recreate its procedural geometry with new parameters. But it is still faster than spawning one from scratch. I don't use pooling for all objects, but I do use it for all the complex objects, such as buildings, interiors, terraces, public spaces, etc. I hide the pooled objects by making them invisible, disabling collision, and moving them somewhere the player definitely won't see them, just for good measure. But pooling alone is not enough, as initializing too many objects from a pool in the same frame can still cause stutter. This is why I have to check how many objects have been initialized or destroyed each frame, and if it's over the limit, stagger any further operations. This puts a hard limit on how much stuff can be spawned in a period of time, and it is the reason I'm limited in how fast I can make my vehicles. Too fast, and the objects that come into view either won't have time to spawn and you'll see empty spaces, or I would have to raise the limit and have a lot of stutter in that situation. Which brings me to the next optimization I use. Despite the issues I've mentioned with high-speed movement, I still wanted to have some fast transport options in the city. So the way I tackle this issue is by varying the draw distances of objects with speed, making them inversely proportional. When you walk or run, the view distance is at 100%, but if you get on a SkyTram, for example, the detail distances scale down as you move, which means the world becomes a lot less detailed. This is a common technique for procedural worlds. I've also seen it used in No Man's Sky, for example. This is also why the SkyTrams are so high above the ground, so I don't have to display interiors while the player is inside, as they would be very obviously low detail. I guess you can still see this effect when you approach a station, though. Most of the geometry that gets generated for Vuntra City is very simple and only requires trivial mathematical calculations. So it can be done in a single frame, provided there are limits on how many objects will get their calculations done, that I've mentioned before. But sometimes a more complex algorithm is required, for example one that involves recursion or some kind of heuristics. Or even just a very long loop that can't be broken up. In that case, I use Unreal Engine's multi-threading functions in C++ to offload that computation to a separate thread. This is not as simple as it sounds, though, as you can't manipulate actual game objects from another thread. That's why I can only use multi-threading for purely mathematical calculations, and have to send an event to the caller on the original thread to actually use that calculation result to manipulate objects. I rarely use this technique, though, because of its limitations. But I do use it for things like generating building addresses, as creating an address for a single building involves calculating all of the nearby streets to figure out the building's position relative to them. And the streets may not be loaded, so I have to calculate their layout from scratch every time an address is requested. Of course, I have a cache of addresses that have already been calculated, but I still have to constantly keep calculating new ones. There are a few more minor optimizations here and there, but that's about it for the major ones. And like I said, I'm not totally happy with the performance right now, so there will be improvements down the line. By the way, if you like my work, consider supporting it on Patreon, as my project is entirely self-funded and every little bit helps. Stay creative!